your father and your vision. Number one, we're talking from Genesis chapter 37. Genesis chapter 37. Every father desire to have a child that carries a vision. As a father, I want to see children that have dreams. Every father's destiny and future hangs around sons that are carriers of vision. Jacob's life would have summarized in Canaan if he never had a son that was a dreamer. The posterity of fatherhood centers around sons that are carriers of vision. I spend my times bringing up people who carry vision. I don't like people who are lost around me. It is useless hanging around me for years without having direction in your life. Walk across the street and go back. Your father and your vision. Unfortunately, many fathers have been killers of their children's vision. Unfortunately, in the continent and the times where we live, many fathers have not allowed children to dream well. I'm speaking. The desire of any true father is to have sons who have visions, is to have sons who are carriers of big dreams. Are you here? Are you here tonight? Are you hearing me? Huh? One of the principal responsibilities of every father is to birth the sons into their visions, into their individual visions. My responsibility towards you is to help you. Come into reality of your vision, your singular vision, is to bring you into the lamplight of your life. If I may break it down a little for someone, let me read a scripture that I've always read here so many times. Proverbs. Proverbs 29 verse 18. Please, when you see us talking something, you should just know. That's maturity. If you follow a man, by the time the man is talking, you already know where he's going to. That's the spirit of a servant.
Where there is no vision, the people perish.
Okay, where there is no vision, the people perish. Simple. Is it clear? Where there is no vision, the people what? Perish. Simple, that means anywhere there is no vision, people don't have a future. The people perish. Simple. So anybody who does not want to perish must have a vision. Now, if I have followers around me that are visionless, I'm leading the people who are heading towards destruction. That's what it means. If I have multitude of like you are gathered here, the multitude online, where there are no visions, the people perish. I don't want to go into that, it's emphasis. That means, if I'm leading children that are visionless, that followership or that relationship has no vision. Because I'm leading the people that are heading towards destruction. Why? Because they are visionless. Okay, somebody give us the NLT version.
When people do not accept divine guidance, they run wild.
They run wild. You get it? When people do Do not accept divine guidance. What happened? Say it again, say the wrong word.
The wrong
word. I'm not hearing you well.
The wrong word.
The wrong word. Why are many people's lives running wild? They don't accept divine. What is vision by the context of the NLT version? Vision means the ability to have access to divine guidance. Are you here? Vision means what? The ability to have access to divine guidance. The ability to have access to divine guidance. Divine guidance, not human guidance, please. Not human guidance. Not societal guidance. But divine guidance. When people do not accept, please. Not like the divine guidance is not available. But the people do not accept. There are many children here suffering today because they have refused to accept divine guidance. Sometimes they say, look at a small child. You don't have anything. You're broke. Sense, you don't get that. Certificate, you don't get that. You pride for it. You look at people at their face, you give them many multitude of excuses. You're looking at them, what's this aunt? I took the LLT because we're moving forward. It says when people do not accept, not like they don't want to give you or they want to give you, but you refuse to do what? Accept it. I have seen many destiny accidents for 12 good years. Many children land in destiny accidents. Many children landed in destiny accidents because you tell them, don't go here. They go. Don't love here. They love. Stop. They say, Papa, I'm accelerating. Again, it's hard. How will you say stop? High gear. How will you ask me to stop when I'm accelerating? I'm on high flight. And you're asking me to stop. Stop how? The child told me, I don't really love the person. Papa, just pray. I tell a lot of people every day, this is the one of the most rebellious, crazy generation of children I look around. The devil knows that when you get guidance, you will excel and go beyond his battle. So he makes sure you refuse and resist guidance. That's what he's doing to a lot of people. When people reject divine guidance, they run wild. What do you mean running wild? A man that is running without control. People run wild. Many sons are running wild. Don't forget, by that context of the scriptures you read, it means vision is the ability to access divine guidance. I'm emphasizing it. Vision is the ability to access divine guidance. I am who I am because I accessed divine guidance as a young man in the university. I have a lot of strong focus. Some of you know nothing has pushed me all these years. There is something my head is sticking on. There is something my eyes is sticking on. I'm focusing on something. For many years, I've seen people went, they left me, came back, strolled around, went through 360 degrees, and then they met me back at the center. They left me here, they went like this. They tasted 360 degrees, then they came back and met me here. I can't help you beyond your ability to accept divine guidance. Even God cannot help you. Salvation is free, but not everybody has it. He cannot help you outside your will. He cannot help you outside your cooperation. He cannot help you outside your participation. It is impossible. Even me, yours, servant, can't help this your people that you are giving outside their cooperation. I can't help anybody here outside your cooperation. He said, like, I cannot help you. Never. I'm emphasizing this to you as a reality. When people don't have, why do they run wild? They run wild. They love and re-love and for love and out of love and switch love. Because they are running wild. How can you be loving six people at one time? And how can six people love you in 10 times? They're running wild. Running wild. You start, this is not working, you stop. You just, who asked you to be startings? Who guided your startings? Who guided you into what you started? A child start up something and comes and tell you, "Well, Papa, I don't start up, bless him." Can you imagine? And I used to look at spiritual witchcraft and I asked God that, does this child understand what she's doing or he's doing? Does he know me? How did you start it? Who guided you into it? When people reject divine guidance, they run wild. When people reject divine guidance, they run wild. They run wild. Very wild. So what is the next thing there? Vision helps you not to run wild. When you have vision in your life, it helps you not to run wild. Message.
If people can't see what God is doing, they stumble all over themselves. But when they attend to what He reveals, they are most blessed.
Did you see that? If people can't see what God is working out, is doing, they stumble against themselves. Look at it. They stumble against themselves. They stumble against themselves. I take you to the third point. When people lack the ability to see, that's vision, they become problem creators. You see a lot of conflicts? People are fighting themselves. They stumble against themselves. What does it mean to stumble against yourself? Number one, it means living a life of comparison. They begin to compare their life with others because they are not seeing anything about it. See the person, me and you come on that, you don't go in. See the one, people just me, see me, see my life, now it's the apple of my life, they stumble against themselves. They begin to live a life of competition. We marry the same, do I not get picking, I never get picking. Shut up, you're a fool. They stumble. People begin to climb your measuring rods. They stumble against themselves. Your inability to see. You begin to look people as your measuring rod. What does that connote? They live a life of competition. Are you there? Comparison is different. Competition is different. That was the next thing about my stumbling itself. Lack of vision puts you into a place where you begin to live a life of what? Competition. You are in ministry, competing with left, X, Z, B. You're doing whatever. You're competing. I tell people every day, watch all my tape. There is no minister of God on the earth. I'm in rivalry with. I'm different. If I show up, you know I'm different. I have a special way of carrying my things, doing my things, going with my message or whatever. I don't care who says A or who says B. Man is not my measuring rod. God's voice and principles and whatever He wants me to do is me weighing whether what He showed me, I've accomplished it. Have I gotten there or not yet? It is that finish point that is my measuring rod. It's not about we saying what. Man can approve you when God has, does not approve you, when God has disproved you. Amen? Are you hearing what I'm saying? So he says they stumble against themselves. What does that connote? Vision takes you off a life of competition, where you have the ability to see what God is doing. If you have the ability to see what God is working out, a life of competition ceased. A life of measuring and comparing your life with others ceased. I'm too busy to know what is even happening around some people's life. People were here, knew that I walked into this place in the night. We were walking in here. I left the class from writing an exam. I walked in here. The driver was here. You were here. We went. I dedicated a place. Did everything. I came to pick you that was arriving. I drove. The car had a problem. I went there. They should change it because I'm using the car in the morning. Straight back. Came here. Walked all through the night. We left here at 9 a.m. I went home. I just entered the bed. Straight to Boya. Entered the class. Wrote the exam. Straight. We were driving on the road like some men on high fire. And we got back into Lima. Just entered the bed. Moved back in here. I'm here. Straight back here into a meeting. And I've released one of my son who is handling something. And I'm back here. Who would believe that I was preaching while writing exams? I don't even have a life. I don't even know whether something, even you're looking for someone to say, well, you say, listen, let me, people who talk are visionless people. The bench of idleness is the bench where gossip springs from. And idleness is a brood talk of visionlessness. Just say what I tell you. That's my schedule. That's the schedule I'm driving on. And then a child came, well, Papa, I could not come because I'm writing exams. I was writing exams, I was in the meeting all through. And I was the last person to leave the meeting. So who is fathering you? You, when you're writing exams, you escape from God. You escape from attending meeting because you are someone. You are writing the most awesome, ultimate, or whatever, all kinds of exams is on your life. Jesus says, all what I do is what I see my Father doing it. I asked you that question, did I? I said, well, Papa, I'm writing my exams. I press my button. I say, Papa, the test. It's in my book, if I like, you can pick my dad, actually, I wrote the date, your response. So, your tithe for one day is 2.5 hours in God. Can pay 1/10 of 24 hours God gives you. It belongs to God. So you write exam with plus body tithe. There are just simple, basic principles in God you people don't know. You don't mean that you're going to church. You are not learned. Bible says you've not so learned Christ. You are not taught. The worst thing is when God starts lifting you, you start claiming beauty. Because he looked your faithfulness at the level, then he lifted you. So he expects that as he's lifting you more, you should be more faithful and committed into him so that he can lift you up again. But now when he gives you a premature, Chris-arata, small lifting, you use that lifting, that blessing, and turn it to a curse. You have multitudes of excuses you give it to him. How can he give you the bigger ones? Do you know that when Ruth came to Boaz, to Bethlehem, the first blessing God gave her was following the workers of Boaz and be picking the grains? But that was not what God had for her. God had the whole estate for her. But God tasted her with the grains. Most of you are under the grain levels. The lack of faithfulness causes you not to see the heights. If you want to follow a man, know the secret that make that man. It's my job to tell you. That's my job. I did not read the whole of night. I was working at this conference. I had meetings, working, documents. That's why you're filling documents. I am not done in filling the documents. I'm talking all over different stop or whatever. For the few minutes I had, the few one I wanted to focus. When people lack the ability to see what God is doing, he says what happened? They stumble against wine and water. Do one. They are quarreling. They are always in offense. They are always in complaint. This person did this to me. Please, move to 15 persons. Say, I beg you, don't stumble against me. I beg you, in the name of God. This year, don't stumble against me. I beg you. I am begging you. Anybody with the Living Bible, can you read me the Living Bible?
When there is ignorance of God, crime runs wild. But what a wonderful thing it is for a nation to know and keep its law.
When there is the ignorance of God's guidance, crime increases. So you can see the reason why Cameroon has a lot of crimes. The causes of the devastating state of our nation is traceable to visionless citizens. Let me reduce it from the level of citizens. The causes for the devastating state of Cameroon's economy is traceable to the visionless life of the youth. Because the problem we are inside is highly propagated by young people. And it's traceable to visionlessness. When there is no vision, people wander aimlessly. I've written a book on running with a vision, so I have all the versions. They wander aimlessly. That means they live a life without goals. People cast off restraint. Cast off restraints is the ability to live a life without discipline, to live a life without control. When there is restraint, that means you are controlled. When you are restrained on something, that means you are controlled. Vision brings control into one's life. Visionlessness causes you to live a life outside control. The devil says, stand here. So when they say, Papa says, stand here and they stand me. You just say, you don't pass the test. You don't know Papa, so they don't apply your own way. After you talk all the next day, you bring your head, say, they don't press me. Things are like this on me, oh. This is happening to me, oh. And I look at you. Because you don't want restraint. I was with one child, I came into a meeting in Boy. I think I was sitting in the meeting or whatever I was sitting. The child is sleeping on a very good mattress, I'm sleeping on the carpet. But the child wants to hear God and know God. I move into you into a meeting, I need that you are standing up. You are the bishop. Yours, your servant is kneeling down. If you know how to stand up, knee down, your papa knee down, you sleep. That's the spirit of a son. Those are not things you should talk about. The day Pat Deboye came to dedicate the Dunamis Center, when he approached the altar, he knelt down and gave a song. As Paul and Nensha saw him going on the floor, he knelt down. One of my daughter told him, said, Papa, this is father to some relation. I said, no, he didn't need to go sleep. Because the person, he be second generation. So your grandfather is kneeling, you should sleep. Every father is interested to have children that carries vision. And I said, number two, the future of every father, the prosperity of a father and a family centers around children that carries vision. Do you know the famine would have killed Jacob irrespective of the amount of wealth he left the house of Laban with? And kill all his children and his everything. his wife, if he never had a son that had a dream? The Bible says it was so severe until Israel sent the student to go and look for food somewhere else. That means if the son never had a dream, the entire family would have perished. Isn't it? If I be a spiritual father to you, I believe if you have a vision tomorrow, it is prosperity for me. You saw my son talking to him on this last one. He's talking from his church. I'm expected to be there. Many a times he has issued things or whatever, they want me, whatever. I'm expected to be there. Many others. Tomorrow some of you will be sons, some of you will be fathers. I'm not just talking to you like what I'm seeing today. I'm saying that the best thing you should have, hang your life around sons who carry vision. No, make it a priority on your life to give your son or put your sons and daughters to grab a vision for their life. Make it your singular priority to catch a vision for their destiny. If you do that, you have secured them not only today, you've also secured the future. If you do that, you are not only secure today, you have secured the future. And don't forget, I said vision. He said when they lack divine guidance, is the ability to assess divine guidance. When they come to meet you as a spiritual father, and they said, I'm thinking to do this, ask them, how did you get it? Ensure the vision is from God. That guidance, that thing they want to move into, is godly and is godly inspired. Because let me tell you, whatever Bible says, Jesus is the author and the finisher. Anything God's author, he must finish it. Amen. Anything you author can stop. Anything a man gives you can die. But if God gives you something, it has a future. The people in Genesis chapter 11 on the building of the Tower of Babel, God didn't ask them to build the tower. It was their humanistic desire. Their humanistic desire that crave for fame. Let us make a name for ourselves. The crave, the desire for fame. They embarked on something that was outside divine guidance, and he ended happily. It did not end, it did not finish. Now you ask me, why do many Christians start some things and it doesn't work? Check it very well, the source is ungodly. Why do many visions that people call so-called visions die? They start up a business. You don't do business because you want to make money. If that's your desire as a Christian, then you're a fool. I don't believe I should be say I want to do business because I need money, whatever. Everything God wants your life to do should be centered with focus, centered with the divine agenda. Let me tell you, I have said to a lot of people, I don't touch things and it doesn't work. You know why? Because I found the secret. It's God. So when I tell you, you come and tell me somebody wants to marry you, and I said, wait. You think I don't love you? That's not it. If you get into something that doesn't work tomorrow, you owe me. You'll be very offended with me. Because how could, if someone get into something that God was not inside, and the person did not have a father or have anybody guiding him or her, it's better. But if you have a prophet and a servant of God over your life, why should you be in the same pot soup of people who don't have that coverage? I don't know that I'm talking to someone. Are you hearing me? Listen, it's called spiritual father. That means I should spiritualize what you want to do. Please don't physicalize me. Allow me to spiritualize the matter. Please do like this to your neighbor. It is called spiritual father and son. Do like this to your neighbor. Say, I'm talking to you. It is called spiritual father and sonship relationship. And then tell the neighbors, please don't physicalize Papa. Don't physicalize him. Don't physicalize him. It's grammar. Is it not grammar? Eh? Number two, say, don't emotionalize Papa. They will come, they keep their face as if somebody has died. If you don't give them respond, see, they come sometimes with very fallen faces, and then they make you look like you are the person who has to crucify Jesus the second time, or you are crucifying because you are not giving an answer. No. If there is one person you should not put under pressure, it's your spiritual brother. If they have not heard the voice of God with you and said you want to go, don't hurry. Marriage is life, it's not a dead thing. After you have went to school, you've done primary, secondary, all this, like all those of you, the books that are inside you, the certificates people have. And then you use one wrong decision and destroy everything you've built your life for. Do you really think about it? For once, do you sit down and consider these realities? Have you ever thought of it once and its implications? So we see that the life of Jacob was secured in the future because of the dream of Joseph. The vision of Joseph. He had 12 sons, only one had a vision. You're not hearing what I'm saying? I say, how many?
12.
Say it again.
12.
Only one?
Had a vision.
Say it again.
Only one had a vision.
And it is that one that had a vision that gave meaning to his life. It is that one that made him to stand before presidents. It is that one that made him to, he said he entered Egypt. The king, Pharaoh came and Jacob laid his hand upon him. You don't hear what I'm talking about.
Yes.
You every day I'm coming around, it's never who I'm hungry. Grace. There are people who just come and they are taking grace from different places and making it work. I said to someone, I was talking to someone, I said, there are people who have not sat down and taught them VKS all through the night, all through the day. But the amount of blessings they have blessed my life is beyond people who have taught them physically. I've labored my life. The amount of honor I see. I've grown to learn much. It has taught me a lot of lessons. And one of the reasons God asked me to summon this meeting is to tell you that He wants you to carry your vision individually. Your vision is what I want you to have. Jacob had 12 sons. Only one had a vision. I'm emphasizing it. I've said to many of my sons and daughters, I am in Cameroon. There are things I can do by the blessings of God over my life. Carry that vision that you have. Let's follow the documents at the corridors of the government house so that you have papers before I start getting the soul abused and abusing. Some of you have written it and put it under your bed. You don't, maybe you have forgotten. You're just living life. Let me tell you, Christianity is beyond activities. Going to church is an activity. Live for a reason. Give your life a meaning. Live with a focus and live intentionally. Live intentionally. I'm speaking to you as a father. Live intentionally. Accept divine guidance and accept what God is saying. When people reject divine guidance, the boy who had the vision shared the vision with his 10 brothers, because by then Benjamin was still young. They hated him. What does that connote? People who have not ascended the levels of spiritual maturity to become fathers might never believe in your dream and your vision. Might never believe in your vision. But he said it to his father. He said, I saw the sun, the star, and the moon. And the father said, do you mean me, my wife, and your brethren? Will bow before you and serve you tomorrow. The father interpreted the dream. Who is a spiritual father? Is someone you can talk your dream to. Someone you can dream and you don't understand the dream and you can take it to him. Someone you're having a direction on something but you don't really have the confirmation, you can go to and say, I'm having a conviction about this. I came to seek your guidance. I came to see you to guide me on this topic. I've seen this thing, I don't understand. I have an impression, maybe an inner witness. Something is witnessing within me, and I want to find out. You have a spiritual eye. You have a mind of God. A spiritual father is an interpreter of the visions of his sons. I repeat. A spiritual father is an interpreter of the visions of his sons. A spiritual father will not fight your visions, will not fight your dreams, will not fight you. He is an interpreter. Brethren, I'm trying to say that a father will not fight your vision, except the person is not a father to you. A father will want to catch a vision for your life. You think that all through your life I want you to come and be turning around on the corridors? Do you think that's it? That's not it. I wonder when you're built here, leave this place. He said they are taking the lead as stars in their various fields of life. Our job is to give you your field. Go there and take the lead. Do you hear what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
I don't know whether you're hearing me. Are you hearing me?
Yes, sir.
Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
Go there and take the lead. Work. Labor. If you say, God don't call me be pastor, be one of the best pastors Cameroon has never had. If you say, God has called you to open a church, have a church very neat, very clean, standard church. Somebody entered and knows already in heaven. Leave this ancient of these things that they said as it was with our fathers, so it is now. Shut up. Leave those things. The gospel has not changed. God has not changed. The people have changed. Don't be a church. Do ministry. Let someone know you're doing ministry. Are you hearing me? Huh? Go there and take the lead. You say God is calling you to politics. Go there. Become a visionary. You know what I've been working for? We're supposed to have gathered here. The same number here, cars are parked out there. You think every day I want to see you, people are coming. Well, Papa, I'm going to go call boss, make a carry. Shut up. For 12 years, people followed Jesus for 3.5 years. It was over. For 12 years, please don't have it. I'll buy all the cars myself. I see you, I throw you water. That water is intentionalized water. So that you feel the effect of prayer without results. Some are born again, 7 years, 9 years. Who cares about the durability? Labor hard, work hard, commit yourself to a cause and become something. Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
I've told you this is a night. By the time you leave this place, all this desperation for marriage is foolishness, visionlessness. Desperation. You want married with all us? A lost lady is looking for marriage. When I said lost, I didn't say you are lost in a bush. You have 2 eyes, 2 ears, and you are very educated. The lost. I've met a lot of lost academicians, lost people. The certificates are there, but very lost. And you are desperate for marriage. Marriage will look for you. Just get yourself on course. Come and say, marriage will fall on you. You don't even know what to do. I have a child now who is 37 years, about 7 suitors around her now. 37 years, on course. You are here with some manageable 2 and 3 or 2 and 7 or 3 and 2. You are desperate. Desperate that you have nothing. Such years you don't have. You are desperate for marriage. Rent for 1 year for pay for 15,000. Look at me. You are desperate for marriage. People don't ask you marry, you see dream and marry them. That marriage is men have a dream. Visionlessness is the root cause of all this nonsense. You look at it, your very good life like this, packaged with a lot of vessel, treasure, glory inside. You make yourself keep it at the mercy of one lost man who is not even settled, or one lost girl who does not have straight focus and correlated cause. And at the end, you say yes, you reach your middle. They say, wait, my thing. Visionlessness. Visionlessness. Wherever you are watching me from, hear me and hear me well. The desire of the Father is that you should carry a vision and be committed to it. Be committed to it. Be committed to that vision, and everything will find you. No man, I'm speaking, no man can believe in your vision. And don't wait for any approval for any man to believe in what you want to do. Just be sure that it's sourced from God. I'm speaking. Be sure that what I want to engage is godly instituted, godly authored. Listen to me. Many people disbelieved this vision you gathered for that vision, the vision you know. At the early stage of the vision I had, I started. Many people left me. Many people backed off. Many people say whatever they want to say. They said a lot of things. I stood my grounds. I kept my course. The mind of many people are changing. Whatever God is impressing in your spirit, keep your focus. Close your ears to the noise around. Refuse to give attention to what people are saying. Stay on course. They will join you in the middle soon.
Amen.
A lot of people have joined me along the way. A lot of people have come to meet me and they are repenting day and night. I said, we never thought this. I'm speaking to someone here. There is a vision you have on your hand and you think that you can't push it through. I have come with the word of the Lord to tell you, as a father, you can push that thing through.
Yeah.
I say you can push it through.
Yeah.
I say you can push it through.
Yeah.
I don't care the challenges you're facing, but I came to tell you, if God alters it, God will bring it to manifestation.
Yeah.
If God said it, all what you need to know, if he said it.
Yeah.
Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
If he said it. If God says you should marry somebody, if you don't have money, marry the person.
Yes.
I want to ask my son, you should mark that. When people reject divine guidance, if divine guidance is coming to you on a subject, on somebody as a man, forget about anything. Marry that person. Obey the voice of God. If God speaks, and you are certain that God speaks, and there are authorities that have told you that this is the will of God, marry that person.
Amen.
It is just a matter of time. Brethren, any business God has asked you to do, any project, step out. As you leave this meeting, step out.
Amen.
I said, as you leave this meeting, step out. Enough of staying at the same level. Enough of sitting and waiting for people's confirmation. The environment will never tie to your direction. Please, it's an error. I repeat, the environment will never validate your direction. Please, somebody like me, all my environment rejected my direction. The spiritual body, apart from my spiritual father, rejected my direction. My internal house as a family rejected my direction. They didn't see it as a curse for the time, but that was what God was saying. Don't wait for some things to delay your destiny. If God is speaking, brethren, step out. My spiritual sons and daughters, please step out. Take the steps of faith and the shield of faith and watch God do the own. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Let God do the things that you have prayed and fasted for and you have not seen him. I am speaking to someone here prophetically from this altar that God has ministered to you and you are seated on the same point and asking questions. But the Lord is talking to me. It's time. Delay it no more further.
Amen.
Delay it no more further. Arise. Take off your future. It is time to take off. 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 According to the years and the things I have shown you in time memorial and time past, that which I told you I will do, now is the time, now is the season. Delay it no more further. Until you move in my leadings, you can't find my provisions. Until you move in my leadings, I'm speaking in prophecy, I'm already prophesying. You can't find my provisions. Until you move in my leadings, you can't find my provisions. Until you move in my leadings, you can't find my provisions.